university life comes with dreams. Architect, engineer, lawyer, entrepreneur, musician, or a dancer. But few doubts shadow these dreams. Will I get the right assistance? Will I meet the right industry expectations? Will I have access to the right training? Rest assured, at Rewa University, Bengaluru, all these questions are answered. This boundless campus of the university has been scripting success stories for years.
From scratch, I started building this from 50,000 square foot to now we have about almost 20 lakh square foot of buildings, infrastructure. Some 300 to now we have about 15,000 students, 1,500 faculty members. Within the 9 years of inception of Rewa, this is the first institute on invitation got within the short time as a university in the country.
Rewa offers a wide variety of courses ranging from engineering sciences to MBA, BBA, media studies and performing arts. And these students here testify how the university is helping them discover their identity.
Our curriculum is designed on the basis of the time period of 6 months, sometimes it is one year, where we learn and we'll explore the new opportunities in the global environment. Now, the digital media is blooming, so we are giving a lot of contemporary training in terms of the social media and social media platforms and social media marketing.
After I finished my PUC, I was looking for a graduate degree at Arts and Humanities. So when I first came to the university, I liked the ambience of the university. It was very huge. And when I talked with the professors, they took me through the course of activities they had planned for us. So they took me through the syllables and what all the activities they had planned was in the future. So I felt like secured and I felt like I could do something here. I could explore my creativity and have a good future ahead. So I think that's the reason I prefer this college. Also, like when I talked to the professor, he was very friendly, he was very encouraging. So I felt like I belonged here, like in a sense.
So my dream was to accomplish a course that would have an impact on my life and further help me for pursuing my dreams very well. I thought about experiencing the diverse cultures of the society as being in Rewa. There are vast students from various backgrounds, various cultures. So for that reason, I thought it would be a really good approach for myself. And despite being in this course of psychology, it will help me experience about new people, new environment, new cultures, and various other things as well.
Good afternoon. I'm Chandan Raikar from Department of Media Studies, Rewa University. We are happy to have our first session of our national level faculty development program on contemporary approaches in media. I request all the attendees to please turn off your web cameras and keep your microphones on mute. However, you may unmute them during the question and answer session. Also, please note that it is mandatory to fill in the feedback form to get your e-certificates. The platform will be provided at the end of the session in the chat box. Over to Ms. Bhagya now to introduce our guest for today's session.
Good afternoon and welcome all. Let me begin the session by introducing our guest today, Professor B.P. Mahesh Chandra Guru. He hails from Karnataka with a family background of agriculture and government service. He has obtained his master's degree in journalism and mass communication from the University of Mysore and PhD in development communication from Mangalore University. He has served for about 4 decades as a journalist and development researcher, media scholar, and social activist in the country. he has served as Professor of Journalism and Mass Communication, Director of Students' Welfare, Program Coordinator of National Service Scheme, Examiner of Karnataka Public Service Commission, Union Public Service Commission, Member of Board of Appointment in various universities, Member of Karnataka Media Academy, and Member of Peer Group of National Assessment Accreditation during the last 4 decades. He has also actively worked in a number of academic bodies, working groups, and expert committees. He has presented a good deal of papers in the national and international conferences and presided over several technical sessions. He has published widely in academic journals of reputed journals in India and abroad. He has successfully guided 30 research scholars and adjuncted PhD theses in Indian and foreign universities as a subject expert. He has been a visiting professor at prestigious universities and research institutions in India. Besides being an educationist and activist, he is a writer of standing in Kannada and English with 20 books. He has activated a reputation as an innovative and scholarly academician in the developing countries. He is a media and research consultant to leading corporate houses and NGO in India. He is a recipient of several awards for professional excellence and social service. We all welcome you here today, sir. Over to you. Professor Mahesh, over to you.
Sir, you may please unmute your microphone and start speaking.
Professor Mahesh, I hope you're able to hear us. Kindly unmute your microphone.
ಮಹೇಶ್ ಕೇಳಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೆಯಾ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ? ಗುರುಳ ಕೇಳಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೆಯಾ? ಹಲೋ,
Looks like there's a technical issue that my sir is facing. So please wait until we just sort this out. We'll be starting with my sir very soon. All the attendees, please note that you will have to fill in the feedback form that is provided at the end of the session. The link of the feedback form will be provided in the chat box. So please look into that. And only if you fill that, you'll be provided with your e-certificates. Thank you.
University life comes with dreams. Architect, engineer, lawyer, entrepreneur, musician, or a dancer. But few doubts shadow these dreams. Will I get the right assistance? Will I meet the right industry expectations? Will I have access to the right training? Rest assured, at Rewa University, Bengaluru, all these questions are answered. This boundless campus of the university has been scripting success stories for years.
From scratch, I started building this from 50,000 square foot to now we have about almost 20 lakh square foot of buildings, infrastructure. Some 300 to now we have about 15,000 students, 1,500 faculty members. Within the 9 years of inception of Rewa, this is the first institute on invitation got within the short time as a university in the country.
Rewa offers a wide variety of courses ranging from engineering sciences to MBA, BBA, media studies and performing arts. And these students here testify how the university is helping them discover their identity.
Our curriculum is designed on the basis of the time period of 6 months. Sometimes it is one year.
I request all the attendees to please switch off your web cameras.
Very good afternoon, Sudeshna Das.
Gurugulaya, good afternoon. Manjunathili.
Very kind of you.
Yes, Gurugulaya, Surachulina. Good.
Yeah. Hello.
Sir, kelustha ide namge.
Kelustha ide sir, matadla.
Matadi kelustha ide. Yes sir, go ahead.
Okay sir, thank you sir. Very good afternoon to all the participants. I am highly thankful to the organizers of this webinar for giving me an opportunity to share my thoughts about content analysis as a media research approach. And we all know well that without scientific research, there cannot be systematic development of modern institutions, including the media. Research is carried out to find out the facts about the status of the organization or service or products. In the media also, we conduct SWOT analysis in order to know the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats associated with a phenomenon, system, process, or program. Content analysis is one of the major research methodologies which is adopted by contemporary researchers in media and social science mainstream. Now, I would like to focus your kind attention on the concept of content analysis, what it is. Content analysis is carried out by the researchers to examine patterns in communication in a replicable and systematic manner. It varies between academic disciplines. It involves systematic understanding of the texts or artifacts which are assigned labels or codes. Researchers also analyze the patterns of contents qualitatively and quantitatively by using certain appropriate statistical methods. Computers are also used increasingly in the present times to automate the labeling or coding of various texts in the print and the electronic media. As you know, earlier it was done manually. Now we are using advanced computer technologies to conduct content analysis in a very precise, comprehensive, and understandable way. I would like to recall the human contributions made by Berylson, who is highly regarded as the father of content analysis. Way back in 1952, Berylson wrote a monumental book entitled Content Analysis. He defined content analysis as a research technique for the objective, systematic, and quantitative description of the manifest contents of communication. This methodology basically includes sampling, reliability, presentation, and modes of inference in the process of media research. Content analysis was defined by Holstein in 1969 as a technique for making inferences by systematically and objectively identifying specified characteristics of messages. The contents of print and electronic media are objectively assessed in order to find out what they mean, how they impact, and most importantly, their strengths and limitations. The contents of print and electronic media are subjected to systematic evaluation of the manifest contents of communication. Gerlinger, another well-known authority in the world on content analysis, defined it as a method of communication analysis as well as observation. Content analysis is a versatile research tech in mass communication and other branches of social science research, where data are obtained from various documents including the print and electronic media. Even digital contents are also subjected to evaluation with a view to note their implications on the audience and others. As a research methodology, content analysis approach facilitates systematic and scientific drawing up valid conclusions on the select research problem. Researchers draw conclusions, inferences, place recommendations for the betterment of the quality of contents in the process of communication, regardless of the channels of communication. Krippendorf, another important personality specialist, noted that content analysis is a prominent method of analyzing the textual fabric of contemporary society. Interpreting communications as texts in the context of their social issues distinguishes content analysis from other empirical methods of inquiry. Researchers examine the conceptual aspects of content analysis by applying evaluative techniques and facilitate better understanding of various subjects. Another authority by name, Chadwick, observed that content analysis involves systematic coding of messages of information into categories, thus allowing for quantitative analysis. Therefore, content analysis is a method which provides a precise means for describing the contents of any sort of communication in the media. Most important aspect of content analysis is that the researchers grasp the essentials, identify the implications, draw inferences, and suggest certain methods for the improvement of delivery of messages in the media. This is the essence of content analysis as a matter of fact. I would like to touch upon briefly the evolution of content analysis, how it evolved over a period of time as a means of fact finding and placement of judgments about the credibility and validity of the contents offered by media and other means of communication. As a matter of fact, in 1600, some theological studies were conducted. The authorities of the church had examined the contents of printing of non-religious materials, which posed certain threats to them. They thought that civilians have no right to question them. They thought that they are the divine representatives of His Almighty. They also took the people for granted in the name of religion, God, and other things. The 17th century contributed very little to the methodology of content analysis due to inherent limitations in terms of technologies, tools, approaches, etc. Content analysis was confined to analyzing religious communicative contents during 17th century. The social and cultural issues were examined by the philosophers in the 18th century by following the methodology of content analysis. The political thinkers, sociologists, and others had used the content analysis as a method for understanding the mass media in social and political contexts. how they affected social system, how they affected political system, how they affected the attitudes, behavioral patterns, and actions of the people. These were primarily examined by the researchers by adopting the method of content analysis. Another important aspect, content analysis was conducted by sociologists and journalists in America during the late 19th century. It was adapted for historical and political research. In the beginning, there was mass production of knowledge resources in the 20th century. In America, there was a boom in newspapers, created mass markets and interest in public opinion. The schools of journalism and mass communication had also adopted quantitative print media analysis, which strengthened the foundations of scientific content analysis. That is another important aspect. Content analysis was primarily confined to only print media in the beginning. Please note, it was print media centric content analysis till 19th century. And the development of electronic media had facilitated the adoption of content analysis, which dealt with the impact of electronic media on culture, society, politics, and other spheres of human life. Researchers had concentrated on the analysis of political propaganda carried out by the media. The intellectual resources were also subjected to systematic content analysis by the researchers in several disciplines. They also employed certain statistical tools borrowed from other disciplines to undertake systematic content analysis. The speeches delivered by the Nazi propagandists Joseph Goebbels, Hitler, and other fascists were also extensively examined by the scholars through content analysis methodology. Grounds were prepared for the evolution of democracy in the world by various political thinkers and organizers. Content analysis gained significance during World War II, which was fought between fascists and Democrats. The propaganda analysts working during World War II constructed such models more or less explicitly. Content analysis practically produced volumes of data on different issues, trends, and developments in the world. There was a new trend of generalization of measures of meaning over a wide range of situations and cultures. Content analysis was widely used by the media and social science researchers in 1940s and 1950s. In the beginning, content analysis was done manually by the researchers. It's a time-consuming intellectual exercise which involves both human errors and time constraints. By human errors, we mean perceptual errors, attitudinal errors, behavioral errors, ideological or other kinds of affinities may also obstruct the very conduction of objective content analysis. Human prejudices, human errors are part of it, undoubtedly. Computational linguistics, word processing technology, and computational content analysis were undertaken by the researchers in 1960s thanks to computer revolution and media revolution. Content analysis primarily included proper understanding of semantic relationships rather than just presence. Semantic relationship. What is perceived by the people, how the contents affect the mindset of the people, and even behavioral patterns. This is called semantic relationship, basically. Another important aspect, content analysis is carried out by the researchers in different contexts, historical, cultural, ideological, educational, political, economic, technological, scientific, and other contexts. It is universal. Content analysis is universal by nature. The contents of newspapers and magazines were primarily examined by the early researchers in America and Europe to ascertain the trends in the communication contents. Laswell and Leeds had undertaken a project to examine the enemy propaganda, which resulted in the development of content analysis as a full-fledged scientific method. Harold D. Laswell is a highly reputed media scholar. He also described the process of communication, who says what, through what channel, to whom, and with what effects. He described the process of communication. Effects constitute the most important element of the process of communication. The ultimate objective of conducting content analysis is to find out their effects on the mindset of the people, behavioral patterns of the people, cultural environment of the people, and other things. Effects of media matter most, especially from content analysis point of view. Another important thing, in 60s and 70s, particularly, researchers had also undertaken a systematic analysis of news and advertisements in print and electronic media. You know very well, advertising manufactures the consent of the people in favor of the goods and services. We have witnessed another phenomenon of guerrilla advertising. It creates compulsions, make people accept the point of view or products despite their harmful effects on health, culture, and so on. Therefore, content analysis also focused on particularly the impact of advertising on the people or society in the post-industrial revolution era. Especially the political propaganda was analyzed by using content analysis method in 1980s and 1990s. In the present times, scholars have utilized the development of text analysis software. It's a highly advanced software which facilitates conduction of scientific content analysis. They also use computer-coded approach to find out the veracity, validity, impact, and other aspects. And computer-based content analysis has become a new way of life, especially in the present millennium, dominated by digital revolution, digital age, digital contents, and so on. So these computer-centric advanced tools and technologies have minimized the utilization of human resources for text interpretation, the most important stimulus in the development of computational content analysis is the growing availability of text in digital form. Digitalization of contents is also another way. Content analysis is widely applied in social sciences to examine the impact of various social, political, economic, and cultural issues on the people, because people matter most in any society. Even civil society gives birth to parliament, executive, judiciary, universities, and all institutions. Therefore, people matter most from communication point of view also. It is the delivery of people-centric goods and services which really enhances the credibility and reputation of media institutions. Therefore, the researchers are immensely benefited by the internet search for content analysis using the Google search engine. It's a blessing. It's a new energy. It's a new resource. It's a new power. So we should thank the Google search engine, which has brought the whole world closer to the people in all walks of life. So this mechanism has enriched the process of content analysis in a remarkable way. Now let me touch upon the specific advantages of content analysis. First of all, content analysis is carried out by the media researchers to find out the frequency and extent of space and time allotted to select subjects in the print media and electronic media. As far as print media are concerned, how much space is allotted to select subjects? As far as electronic media are concerned, how much time is devoted to broadcasting of specific subjects matter most? So this is where space and time constitute the most important variables from content analysis point of view. So the content analysis facilitates the examination of frequency and extent. Frequency means how frequently these contents are either disseminated in the print media or broadcast in the electronic media. Extent, quantum, extent of reports, news analysis, reviews, criticisms, editorials, articles, etc. The extent of communication also represents the kind of importance given by the media people to chosen subjects that has to be understood. Second important advantage is that content analysis is undertaken to ascertain relative significance given to select themes and other categories of news or subjects by examining the frequency and extent of space and time. So here, significance. If prime time television viewing is respected by the people, it is because of the timing of broadcasting. Front page reporting with good photographs, headlines, and other devices also represents the significance. The miscellaneous stories the miscellaneous broadcasting items do not really represent the practical significance of the contents duly disseminated by the media. Content analysis also facilitates proper understanding and difference of the differences, understanding of the differences in the frequency and extent of space and time. For example, local, regional, national, and international issues and items, how well they are covered or disseminated by the media. Content analysis enables the media researchers to find out the direction of treatment of select themes in the print and electronic media news items. Treatment of themes matter most. How prominently, how seriously, how fairly, how judiciously certain issues, concerns, trends, and developments are treated by the media is also the chief focus of content analysis, broadly speaking. Content analysis has the potential to identify trends over a long period of time and describe the media contents in the context of real world. Please note, there is real world and real world. So the readers, the audience, and other users can very well understand the occurrence of certain trends, developments over a period of time, and in what way they matter most, especially from the people's point of view. Content analysis is useful in finding out the frequency and extent of space and time to select themes pertaining to various categories of people in the print and electronic media. When you say people, they belong to different categories. It may be blacks and whites. In India, it may be forwards, backwards, minorities, Dalits, tribals, women, and other sections. How well these sections of society are informed, educated, motivated, directed, and led by the media is the prime focus of content analysis. You know well, we have class media rather than mass media. The vacuum created by the mainstream mass media is duly filled by social media, which are media of the people, by the people, and for the people in the new millennium. Social media have come to the rescue of mankind to facilitate constant social networking, social capital development, social mobilization, social change, empowerment, and so on. So people have every right to know as to what extent different sections, different classes, different ethnic groups, different racial groups, different cultural groups are duly considered by the media. More than anything, how well they are treated by the media. So this is where content analysis helps us to know the kind of treatment meted out to different sections of society. Because in a democracy, all are equals. Before law, everybody is an equal citizen. Another important aspect of content analysis is it facilitates discovery of stylistic features and traces the development of scholarship available in media and other platforms. We all know very well that scholarship development, intellectual development, personality development, empowerment of the people are important objectives of the contemporary media. We have a right to know as to whether these media have lived up to the expectations of the people from the points of view of participatory communication, inclusive communication, integrated development, inclusive development, and so on. So this is where content analysis helps us to know where the media stand from human communication point of view, judicious communication point of view. Content analysis also ensures comprehensive understanding of the social, economic, political, and cultural issues for better governance and development. We all know very well, integrated development and inclusive development become possibilities if there is better governance. Gandhiji, who earned freedom against several odds, emphasized the need for Swaraj. Swaraj means freedom. His contemporary and the maker of Indian Constitution, which is regarded as the best constitution in the world, Baba Saheb Ambedkar, emphasized the need for Suraj. Suraj means good governance. So good governance, good development primarily depends upon the very presence of not only intelligent, but enlightened, constructive-minded, and fair-minded citizens in a democracy. So this is where we have to understand that content analysis offers several advantages intellectually, practically, culturally, educationally, economically, politically, and otherwise. Content analysis is carried out in the media system mainly to identify the barriers to communication, explore new avenues of participatory communication, and enable the media organizations to present better contents from people's welfare and progress point of view. Please note, content analysis is not a casual or usual or mechanical exercise. It has to be undertaken by the conscious minds, large-hearted people. Degree-oriented research is good for nothing. People-oriented research, problem-oriented research, solution-oriented research, future-oriented research are the most important endeavors which are required, especially in the new millennium. Now I come to the approaches to content analysis. There are certain well-established approaches to content analysis. Content analysis is widely used qualitative research technique, which is based primarily on three distinct approaches, such as conventional approach, directed approach, and summative approach. What do you mean by conventional approach? Conventional content analysis is generally used with a study design which describes a phenomenon. It is appropriate when existing theory or research literature on a phenomenon is limited. It's also known as an inductive category development according to Mary Ying, a reputed media scholar of our times. Researchers in media and other mainstreams make use of conventional approach to study design and analysis of the contents of communication by using 10 to 15 clusters and umpteen number of quotes. There is a kind of compartmentalized analysis, cluster-centered analysis, item-wise analysis, subject-wise analysis, and so on. For example, historical subjects, cultural subjects, social subjects, gender-specific subjects, weaker sections-related subjects, environment-centered subjects, democracy-centered subjects, human rights-related subjects, civil liberty-related subjects. So there are several subjects which matter most. So content analysis is used primarily to identify these prominent subject categories. If necessary, subcategories also. For example, sustainable development has several items under that. Policy approach, program approach, planning approach, service approach, communication approach, governance approach, evaluation approach, achievement approach. So there are several subcategories within a main category like sustainable development. So United Nations Organization has formulated about 17 goals of sustainable development, including human rights protection, water conservation, good governance, and so on. So scholars make use of the conventional approach to find out what subjects are covered by the media. What is the frequency of coverage? What is the extent of coverage? What is the importance given to that particular coverage? Most importantly, how useful it is from people's point of view, not owners' point of view or market forces' point of view. So conventional approach has certain advantages. It primarily enables the research scholars to gain direct information from study participants without imposing preconceived categories or theoretical perspectives. They are at liberty to know the utility or futility of communication. So this is where most of the research scholars in media, social sciences, and other mainstreams usually follow conventional approach because theories are limited, research literature is limited, even opportunities are limited. It's a difficult intellectual and arduous task, content analysis. There is another approach to content analysis called directed content analysis. Researchers make use of a directed approach to content analysis through the deductive use of theory based on their distinctions and the role of theory, impact of theory. Content analysis using a directed approach is guided by a more structured process than in a conventional approach. The researchers are guided by certain aspirations, certain values, certain motives. They are required to follow well-defined, well-prescribed, practically relevant approaches to content analysis. I told you, it is not casual exercise. It is consciously conducted approach on the basis of certain values, norms, and guidelines. So these three are the important elements which motivate the researchers to conduct content analysis. The researchers make use of the existing theory and provide operational definitions for each category, which are determined using the theory. The researchers, as you are aware, are required to provide certain operational definitions of the terms used in the study to facilitate clarity of thoughts, not only for the benefit of researchers, even for the benefit of users. So they have to give a list of operational definitions. For example, sustainable development, what does it mean? Inclusive development, what does it mean? Integrated development, what does it mean? Gender justice, what it is? Social justice, what it is? CSR, corporate social responsibility, what it is? Therefore, proper concepts, proper definitions, proper approaches facilitate meaningful conduction of content analysis in the real sense. There is one more approach to content analysis called summative content analysis. As researchers, we are aware of three kinds of research: formative research, process research, summative research. Formative research is carried out by the researchers before the launching of a program, a project, a product, or services, mainly to examine the feasibility and utility of the project. If it is not feasible or socially not beneficial, better to give up that particular project. You want to establish one TV channel? Can you establish it in a remote area or a tribal area where you don't get adequate financial resources, intellectual resources, users, and even evaluators? Process research. When a particular project is going on, you go to the people, ask specific questions. What is your attitude about this project? Are you happy about this project? Does it really deliver goods for you people? Are you really enjoying the implementation of the program? Today, we are talking about new education policy. Is it really people-centric? Is it really social justice centric? Is it really relevant in a pluralistic society like India? We talk about online education. Our students in the rural areas, tribal areas, remote areas are least equipped with electronic gadgets. They don't know the meaning of digital literacy. They don't know the meaning of digital literacy. Our friends know very well that we have a great and disturbing digital gap, digital haves, digital have-nots. So process research means, well, doing a particular thing or delivering goods and services, you go to the people, find out whether it is really suitable or not. Summative research is carried out after the completion of the project. You can ask questions like, did you really gain any benefits? Did you really participate? Did you really find it relevant, useful, known for poverty alleviation, known for infrastructure development, known for gender justice, known for rural development, known for some other development? Like that, summative research, summative approach to qualitative content analysis begins with identifying and quantifying certain words or contents in text with the purpose of understanding the contextual use of the words or content. Not only the contextual use, effects, most importantly. So this kind of research is also carried out, broadly speaking, according to Krippendorf, an internationally reputed authority in content analysis. The descriptions and interpretations of the contents are carried out by systematic evaluation of the quality of the contents. Not only quantity, quality of the contents, relevance of the contents, fitness of the contents, usefulness of the contents are primarily evaluated by the researchers in the name of summative content analysis. These are the universally recognized, followed approaches to content analysis. Now I come to the last point, conclusion. Content analysis continues to be a prominent media research initiative despite certain constraints and limitations. The success of a content analysis depends greatly on the coding process. How well you identify certain terms, certain subjects, how well you ensure categorization or compartmentalization. Most importantly, how precisely you identify the meaning, relevance, context, use, and other aspects. A coding scheme is a translation device that organizes data into categories. Coding, social aspect, economic aspect, cultural aspect, scientific aspect, technological aspect, like that. Development of a good coding scheme is central to trustworthiness in research using content analysis. Here, those who participate in content analysis should not be guided by personal whims and fancies, any kind of prejudices. So they should be guided by noble aspirations and noble approaches. What matter most in the effective content analysis of the work? Number one, noble aspirations. Number two, noble approaches. The success of content analysis is primarily dependent on the healthy, constructive, and positive mindset of the researchers. They should be least detached from the subject or even media. They should be attached to objectivity, not subjectivity. Therefore, creating and adhering to an analytic procedure or a coding scheme ensures better trustworthiness or validity of the content analysis. Content analysis becomes highly valid, relevant, useful if it is conducted in an objective, impartial, fair, and responsible manner. So this is how you have to understand the relevance of content analysis as a prominent media research methodology. I thank you for giving me an opportunity and I am open to discussion. You are also agree, you are also most welcome to disagree with me also, because I believe in democracy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for that insightful session, sir. It was a very good, insightful session on content analysis. Now I would want to welcome, some questions and answers, sir.
I have made it simple to the best of my abilities, Darshna.
Yes, sir, definitely. I would ask, if any questions, any queries are there. I would ask the participants to come forward with any questions. You can unmute yourself and you can also come on the camera and ask your questions.
Yeah, most welcome.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Thank you so much for the enlightening session, sir.
Yeah.
I have a question. Can you explain about the computational software, computer-based content analysis tools?
Yes.
Can you name them and then give a brief description too?
You talk about software, madam?
Yes, sir. Softwares.
Actually, I told you about the latest thing. Content analysis is carried out with the help of computers. Earlier, it was done manually, and it posed serious challenges, constraints, and so on. Now, computational linguistics, word processing technology, and computational content analysis are undertaken thanks to the technologies. So we are assured of precision. Even it is visible. You cannot present facts and figures according to your own whims and fancies. It can verify it, it can find out the relevance, and it really benefits both media and users, because contents intelligence, contents consciousness, contents responsiveness, these have to be ensured in the case of content analysis. So we have to do it as rigorously, as precisely, as responsibly as possible.
Okay, any more questions?
Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible. Sir, please introduce yourself before you ask the question, so we would also know.
I'm Dr. Basav Prabhu Jirli from Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
My question is, hello.
Yes, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
Yes, please repeat, sir.
Sir, my question is, can you suggest some softwares that are available for content analysis?
Sir,
any softwares that are available?
Yes, sir. These days, especially in the age of new media revolution, good number of softwares are available, sir. I told you about the Google.
Uh-huh.
It is the most important source and resource, sir. It is the most important source and resource. Yes, sir.
Can you be specific, sir? Google?
So it has become universally accessible. For example, text analysis software is there, text analysis software, computer coded approach is also very much there. Computer based content analysis has gained new momentum. So it is a matter of applied content analysis based on advanced softwares. So we can make use of
we can make them that. If you visit Google or internet, you'll find out umpteen number of softwares which are widely used by the contemporary media researchers.
Sir, again, with a due apology, may I ask you to at least you suggest two softwares so that we can reach them?
Sir, in fact, we have many softwares, but all these softwares do not fit into our context. Context. It should be fitting into the subject context. We can find out the veracity, validity, and relevance of the softwares with the help of many good scholars and specialists. For example, NVO Atlas. It also provides good thing. Research text analytics software, it's also useful. QuirkOS, very useful. MaxCoda, Freedos. There are several softwares which are used widely by the media researchers. And you are at liberty to make use of these softwares according to your convenience. It is not a matter of compulsion, but you have to make use of these softwares according to your convenience. I personally prefer QuirkOS and MaxCoda. These two are widely used, especially by contemporary research.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Yes, anyone else wants to ask questions, you can please go ahead. Questions? Any other questions? You can unmute yourself and ask the question.
Yeah. Thank you, Sudeshna. Thank you, Manjunath.
Hello. Yes, sir.
Hello, Anush Krishna. This is Dr. Dilip Kumar.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. I would like to congratulate Professor Maheshchandra Guru who elaborately explained the methods of content analysis, which is more relevant for the new researcher, upcoming researchers also. So I would like to ask about SWOT analysis to Professor Maheshchandra Guru. So what are the stages we need to be followed while conducting SWOT analysis?
Yes, sir. In fact, please repeat your question, sir.
Sir, my question is very simple, sir. You have mentioned in your presentation about SWOT analysis.
SWOT analysis, yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, my question is, while doing SWOT analysis, what are the stages need to be followed?
Yeah, I agree. I please listen to me. As a matter of fact, Peter Drucker, internationally reputed management expert, gave us SWOT analysis. Analysis of strengths, weaknesses, threats, and opportunities. In the first stage, we find out the status of communication, which is reflected in the contents. Weaknesses, what are the semantic barriers? What are the language barriers? What are the contextual barriers? What are the barriers to effective understanding? That is another stage. Opportunities, how well you can make better presentations than this? What better approaches are needed for presentation? What better means, mechanisms, technologies, tools, etc. are required? Threats. There are several threats to communication. For example, we are now living in the age of intercultural communication. There is a well-established relationship between globalization and intercultural communication. Therefore, we have to be very sure of variables of research. Please note, SWOT represent the most fundamental variables of research, and we have to grasp these essentials. You can have four categories. SWOT, four categories. Under S, what are the subcategories? Under W, what are the subcategories? Under O, what are the subcategories? Under threats, what are the subcategories? We should go on making a very comprehensive list of these aspects and furnish your report which fit into SWOT analysis. It is very easy to do it, provided there is better comprehension. It is not a miracle. It is regularly done in the media, management, politics, and other sectors of life. And it is supposed to be the latest and most appropriate method of conducting content analysis.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Welcome, sir.
I have a question, sir. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, sir. Please go ahead, sir. Sir, okay. Introduce yourself and please ask the question.
I am Abhijit Ganguly, visiting lecturer of Jadavpur University in Journalism and Communication Department. So I have a question that how is there any particular methodologies for doing this content analysis, especially for photographs and media, for photographs and videos and like that? Is there any particular methodologies?
I tell you, it may be traditional media or social media. But we all know very well that social media has filled the vacuum created by the traditional media. Approaches are common irrespective of media. It may be traditional media or social media, but social media contents are known for both advantages and disadvantages. Some of the contents, as you have seen, are fake by nature, based on certain prejudices also. The greatest advantage of social media contents, they are subjected to systematic and scientific documentation. You should have certain variables. For example, what are the objectives? What are the methods? What are the specific points? What are the useful contents? What are the harmful contents? So these aspects demand universal approaches. Of course, as I told to one of your friends, make use of the most appropriate software to analyze the social media contents also. You have to be aware of the most useful softwares. Therefore, you can use certain softwares which can really facilitate conduction of effective, rewarding content analysis of social media. Whether it is print or social, it is your mindset which really matters. It is your competence which really matters. Your confidence also matters. Therefore, there is no specific software or methodology, as a matter of fact. Draw the best features from all the approaches to content analysis and make use of some of them which fit into your context. This is my belief.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, any other questions from our participants? Okay. Sir, I will ask one question, sir, because I have been at the receiving end of this question from my students many a times. It's a very basic question, but I feel that we still need to, ask this question. Can content analysis be done qualitatively? I mean, we have heard of quantitative quantification in terms of content analysis, but many a times they ask in terms of visuals or, in terms of films and all, content analysis, can it be done qualitatively? Is there a concept of qualitative content analysis?
No, you are required to understand the frequency and extent of the coverage of subjects of your choice, or you can say select subjects.
content analysis practically includes both quantitative and qualitative. By quantitative, I mean how much of space is devoted, or how much of time is devoted, how much of importance is devoted. So you can have codes, you can have identification of factors, you can have a list of all these things, you can use appropriate software, you can also quantify your findings. This is quantitative analysis. Qualitative analysis means what is the language of communication, what is the culture of communication, what is the simplicity of communication, what is the understandability of the communication, what is the fairness of the communication, what is the social benefit of communication. These are qualitative aspects: word, language, grammar, construction, appropriateness, correctness, precision. These aspects constitute the qualitative analysis. So it will be better if it is based on both quantitative and qualitative analysis. Practically, content analysis is based on quantitative and qualitative approaches.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. If we do not have any other questions, I will move on towards a small formal vote of thanks for our beloved sir here. So I'll start off with a vote of thanks, sir, to end our session. I would like to extend our heartfelt thanks to our teacher, our guru, Professor Mahesh Chandra Guru, for this insightful talk on the various aspects of content analysis and coding. Sir, your body of work and research in this area is vast, and we are thankful that you could share your insights and in-depth knowledge and research experiences with us through this exploratory online medium in these difficult times. Sir, your enthusiasm to adapt and teach and instruct in this new medium earns all our admiration, sir. And we hope you remain associated with us in many such teaching learning sessions in the new normal. Sir, so many thanks for joining us and delivering this talk to kickstart this national FDP from Department of Media Studies, Rewa University. So thank you so much, sir. I would also like to thank the participants who have joined us in this session. We are happy and glad to see participants from all across the country for, you know, on a such short notice. Thank you all for joining the first session of the eight-day national level faculty development program.
Your colleague Manjunath, and most importantly, I dedicate my talk to Professor V.G. Talwar, who is my mentor, guide, and patron. I dedicate my talk to Professor V.G. Talwar, who was your vice-chancellor and also my vice-chancellor in the University of Mysore. Thank you very much, Sudeshna.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I would also ask the participants to keep, join hands with us and remain with us for the next remaining 7 days of this faculty development program. And we are committed to making them as interactive, informative, and futuristic as possible. So please remain with us for the rest of the 7 sessions also. Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
All the best. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Dear attendees, please note the link to the feedback form has been shared in the chat window. You may access that and please fill the feedback form, and only then you will be provided with the e-certificates. Thank you for attending our session. Have a nice day.